So the first one is regarding pre-orders. So we just wanted to start off, wanted to kind of speak to this and apologize for the recent frustration and inconvenience that's been happening with pre-orders.
Okay, people, welcome back to another Foosh Weekly. As always, I'm Robo, and it's a busy week. It's almost as if toy companies are making up for a lull during the holiday season, or they're getting ready for what would have been Toy Fair. So we're just gonna jump right into it. But first, I just wanted to... How's everybody doing? Good? Are you holding up? If not, hang in there, because it's bound to get better. But either way, let's distract ourselves for 20 minutes or so, and look at some new toys. Hot on the heels of the last weekly where I talked about the Metacom, Mafex, The Boys, Homelander, and then the Avengers Infinity War Doctor Strange, you knew that the official solicitations would drop. It was almost at the same time that the weekly published to YouTube on Saturday. But that's okay, more to talk about this week, and does answer some lingering questions. Like, how does Homelander's chest swap work, or what magic is involved with Doctor Strange's multi-arm craziness? Okay, so maybe the solicitations don't answer it definitively, but it does give us more insight. There doesn't seem to be any holes in Doctor Strange's cape, which was my guess. Looking at the arm accessory itself, there seems to be two peg holes that plug into Doctor Strange's back. Zooming in, it appears the two sets of lower arms are a separate piece. You can see the seam line running between those. In the pictures, those are the two sets of arms under the cape. So what I'm guessing, or what these kind of show us, is the bottom two sets of arms plug into the back, the cape lays down, and then some kind of magnet situation plugs the outer above the head arms onto the back of that. And as we all know, magnets work because of magic, and so it's very appropriate here. Metacom also seems to be using that unexplainable magnet power for Homelander's chest. I speculated it was a whole new torso like we saw with Thor, but it's more like the Nolan trilogy Batman's, where just the pec piece pops off. You can see the seam right along the musculature right there. I don't know why I'm using my own chest. Homelander costs $82, and unfortunately, Doctor Strange did turn out to be the $120 that the magazine scan showed. I kind of get it. That's a lot of extras on top of Metacom's usual high price, but ouch. I may wait to see how their Infinity War Captain America turns out before committing to this one, but I do really like the Infinity War Thor. I'm gonna end up with Strange, ain't I? Another magic type character solicited this week was the Mezco 1/12 Collective DC Constantine. Revealed last year during San Diego Comic-Con at home season, which was July, the figure plays up to what I consider Mezco's strengths. Looser clothing for a more realistic look. No masks, no skin tight suit, just a dude in everyday clothes. Don't get me wrong, I like their superhero figures too, but this seems to be more in their sweet spot. Constantine includes quite a few magic effects, two hand flames across Twin Blade and Moon Blade, two lighters, one with flame, one without, chainsaw, and four different heads. Now, truth time, I don't know a lot about Constantine from the comics. I know him more from, well, the Keanu movie, and then his TV series on the CW, and his appearances in Legends of Tomorrow. So I don't know if he gets beat up a lot in the comics, but there are two unscathed heads, one serious, one a little bit cocky, and then two bruised and bloody heads, one cocky, and then one just enjoying himself. A couple of things to note here, though. This figure is not solicited to come with the cigarette-holding hand and the shotgun that were in the original promotional pictures back in July. Mezco straightened out the situation, stating that the license holder asked them to omit the pictures with the cigarette and the shotgun, but without outright saying it, they confirmed that it is coming with those items. I understand smoking comic book characters have been an issue for a long time, but the shotgun confuses me. Most of Mezco's figures, both DC and other properties, have weapons. I mean, we just got Two-Face that has guns. Why does Constantine not get to be shown with his shotgun? Either way, $100 scheduled for August to October of 2021. It ain't a weekly without some McFarlane news, and once again, Todd took to the live streams to show off some not new DC Multiverse figures, but confirm that they're coming. We had already known about the Joker-headed Nightwing, the Bizarro, and the John Stewart Green Lantern, but to see them in Todd's hands being shown to us, that's always a fun thing. Nightwing seems to reuse most of the body we've seen, how many times has it been now? A couple? But then an awesome looking Joker head. John Stewart has been spruced up a bit with some extra sculptural detail on his costume, But then I think I really like the Constructs more than anything. He's got a big Gatling gun, and then the chest overlay. At first I thought it was just part of the figure, but it peels off. You can take it off for just a, well, a more generic Green Lantern look. And then for Bizarro, it's Bizarro. It's Superman, but not quite. Todd went for more of a Frankenstein type look, and I like that it differentiates itself more from Superman. I'm good with the more classic renditions of Bizarro, but this will look good on the shelf next to other DC Multiverse Supermans. Me am not interested. All of these should be going up for pre-order soon, along with, I think originally they showed this with the unmasked Thomas Wayne Batman. So, we'll see. Loose Collector has posted updated pictures of their heavy metal Tarna, and due to fan feedback, they've added a more neutral looking face and a less windswept hairstyle. Even better, you can swap the hair pieces between the two heads, so options are good. I can understand the need for action hair, especially when you come with a flying beast, but I love me a good just standing there about to kick some ass stance. Even better, the extras here do not bump up the $100 price point for the two-pack with Tarna and her big naked turkey Avis that is now up for pre-order on Executive Replicas. Link for that is in the description. Not only that, here's a nice new picture of the Coffin Comics Hell Witch. The skin tones, the wings, the painted metal and shading, oh, just a perfect complimentary piece for Lady Death. And speaking of the Lady Death figure, Loose Collector says those are on their way to the distribution centers, should be shipping out soon. I don't know if I've said it before, but I think I have. One of the franchises I don't know a lot about, or well, a couple of the franchises I don't know a lot about, is Godzilla and King Kong. I never watched a lot of it when I was a kid or when I was growing up. I think I did watch the Godzilla movie from a few years ago, and then I really like Skull Island. For some reason, I haven't seen King of Monsters yet, but with the new trailer of Godzilla vs. Kong hitting, oh, it's got me excited, and I want to go back and watch that now. There's just something about those two going at it, and the way it's filmed, and how the shots are set, and the water splashing and everything. Most of all, that means new Bandai SH Monster Arts figures for both. Now, I don't usually talk about Monster Arts. Again, I know nothing about the franchise. Plus, I try to stick to 6 to 7 inch scale figures. These are definitely not within the realm of those scales. Godzilla scales. But yeah, what I'm getting at here is rubber don't know. Like, is this Godzilla sculpt an all new sculpt? Or is this the first Kong in the Monster Arts line? I don't think it is. I think I have seen that. But looking at it, this may be my first Kong in the Monster Arts line. Basically, I can just ride the excitement of the new trailer and look at the pretty promotional pics. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Whoa! Godzilla looks to only include a couple of extra hands, but Kong has two heads, hand options, and then the juiced up Godzilla spike axe. $68 a piece, scheduled for May overseas and June through Bluefin. Oh, but the giant monster and I guess robot train doesn't stop there. This week, Super 7 had quite a few announcements, one of them being Godzilla. We'll see reaction figures this year, followed by, oh, gonna be a lot of this, Ultimates in 2021. Or I guess you could say, Ultimates. Brian Flynn on Instagram says that if it is a Toho monster, they will get to it. Keeping with the giant theme, this time moving over to robots, Super 7 also announced that they will be making Transformers Ultimate. Looks like maybe a ghost Starscream? And he's sparkly? A bit translucent? Are these the figures I was hoping for when Hasbro announced their RED line? Will Super 7 keep the designs and scale consistent? Guess we'll just have to wait and see, but just today, they also announced Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. Go, go, Power Rangers! The first wave will be, I have to read these off, Yellow Ranger, Green Ranger, Goldar, Tyrannosaurus, Dinozord, and Putty Patroller. And those should go up for pre-order this year. Man, Brian has been busy because Super 7 wasn't just teases this week. They also solicited their Ghost Papa Emeritus the First, or Papa One. I don't know a lot about the band itself. I've just heard a few songs and I've seen the various versions of the lead singer, which makes me think, oh, if Papa One does well, there could be many versions on the way. Two looks are included, black and red robes and hat, then a white and gold. The hats are actually part of the head sculpt, so it's two different heads with the same facial features. But given Papa's look, that makes total sense. And I can't use my usual gripe of both heads should look different. Also has hand options, a microphone, and mic stand. $45 said to ship winter of 2021. And then as far as something fairly close to hitting now from Super 7, remember way back when the Thundercats Wave 1 was about to hit and they fessed up to Panthro shorts being the wrong color and then Jackalman's chest overlay missing some paint. Instead of delaying that shipment, they said they would release a booster pack later with those parts with some extras. This week, thanks to Big Bang Comics over in Ireland, we get our first look at that booster pack. Besides the underwear and shoulders, there's weapons in the correct colors and an extra Panthro head with glowing eyes. You know, for that Big Bang received these along with their order of Panthro and Jackalman, so we should be seeing these soon. I don't know how that'll work if you didn't order directly from Super 7, but hopefully it's a fairly painless process. That's not all from Thundercats though. Last weekend we started seeing teases of the long rumored Thunder Tank, followed directly by a picture of the damn thing with Lino up on top, giving you a sense of scale. You can even kind of peek Panthro in the driver's seat through Lino's legs. So right then we knew it would be fairly large and fairly pricey. Then Thursday, Super 7 hit us with another look and some of the details. Yeah, if you look close, you can see the 3D print lines and everything does look a little rough, but that doesn't worry me. I'm guessing there's still a lot of work to do on the back end, and Super 7 probably didn't want to go whole hog fabrication with it until they gauged customer interest. This thing is going to be big and chunky with the ability to seat 6 Thundercats. It's 27 inches long, 17 inches wide. Pre-orders open next Tuesday for $450. I know. But it's a fairly intricate vehicle with opening parts, the back pops open, there's moving tires, the arms, the jaw, guns, glow-in-the-dark eyes for the headlights, and we can't forget about the samoflange. It's a smaller run from a smaller company for a smaller fan base. The cost is just gonna be higher. But plus side, there will be a payment option available, so that whole lump sum won't be tearing through your toy budget all at once. Another follow-up from last week, we now have promotional images of the Jazzwares AEW Unrivaled Series Wave 4. Starting with the Inner Circle, Sammy Guevara looks a little bit plain with just his sunglasses and sign, but he will also include his leather jacket. Santana will include the water bottle loaded sock that he used on Moxley back at Revolution last year, and then Ortiz comes with the deadliest weapon known to man, the flip-flop. And then both of those will also have alternate heads. Kenny Omega has different ring gear, and is that a new head scan? I think it looks better than previous versions, so not only are they keeping, you know, the EVPs, the headliners out on the market, they're also upgrading them a bit. Same for Cody Rhodes. This head scan looks more refined. The likeness is better. And then there will also be an alternate, more serious head. The basic release has a Thronebreaker shirt, and then the 1 of 1,000 Chase will have a different gear, the Nightmare Family shirt and his neck tattoo. Finally, Matt Hardy in his broken gimmick gear. If the final factory piece looks this good, I'll have to grab two, because one will go in the Matt Hardy display and the other one will just roll around my toy room. On an expedition of gold. Includes several sets of hands, but there is also a 1 of 500 rare edition in different ring gear, but I think it's a lot of reuse from Wave 1 Jericho. I don't think it's as nice as the standard edition, but I'm more attached to the broken gimmick too, so these all should ship late April. Sticking with Jazzwares, another Fortnite Legendary Series update. That's right, all you real, true, serious collectors who think this line is for 4-year-olds, you can go into the other room right now, play with your other toys, while Uncle Robo talks some Fortnite. After Walmart posted a product page for their exclusive Slushy Soldier last October, this week, orders opened up finally. 3 months later, 1 month after Christmas, which I feel like this is some kind of holiday exclusive, but it's been a crazy year. And all the shipping services are behind, and product, and mail, and at least it went up for order, and it stayed up. In fact, last I looked, earlier today, it was still up for order. So, available means you can go get it. Go ahead, go get it. Again, link in the description. But now that my Snowman Warrior is acquired, or at least on its way, I did get a shipping notice, which is always a worry with Walmart. My sights are set on a new target. We had seen Kit on one of the recent card backs, and now Amazon has posted a landing page with pretty promotional pictures to show us how amazing this figure looks. It's part of the new Brawler series, so that already tells us it's going to be bigger than most of the standard figures, but that's not all. It also transforms. At least that's what I'm guessing from this picture of the back of it. I don't know why Amazon didn't post the front of it, but in the game, I think either the legs come off or they flip up over the shoulders, and then the tire in the middle goes rolling down the road. I don't know if this tire actually rolls with everything attached to it, but just the fact that it can mimic that look, that's cool. Plus, the little kitty is a separate piece. You can take it out of the kit gear. And as we all know, cats are evil, so this may hang out with my beef boss. Not that beef boss is evil. He's just misunderstood. What are you talking about? The listing hasn't actually been active yet. Pre-orders haven't been open, but hopefully that's soon because that and Frozen Raven, oh, and Agent Peely. Those are the three I don't have yet. Need. Okay, you can come back in now. We're done talking about kitty toys. On to more serious adult toys. That sounds wrong. Oh, Star Wars! How I've missed you! Today, Friday, was Hasbro's Star Wars Fan First Friday, and we thought we would see more than we did, but there is some new stuff to go through. Some of you may not like it because it's mostly repaints, but oh man, nostalgia is a harsh, harsh mistress. And in true Hasbro livestream style, the festivities actually started Thursday night when Amazon put up pre-orders for the Lucasfilm 50th anniversary throwback Jawa, Greedo, and Obi-Wan Kenobi. Obi-Wan Kenobi. Not only are they retro-carded, they're also tweaked and painted to be more vintage-flavored, like the San Diego Comic-Con Boba Fett or the more recent Bounty Hunter pack of Zuckuss and Forlom. They are Kenner-inspired. The Jawa has a lighter brown paint job on the figure itself and then covered with a darker brown cloak, just like that late 70s version. Unlike the Mandalorian off-world Jawa, though, they kept the plastic robes under the cloth. It makes it a bit more bulkier, but that's how it was on the original figure, even though the inner robes were actually sculpted to the legs. With Greedo, Hasbro removed the vest and then replicated the green paint job all the way down to the darker shade around the shoulders, the elbows, and the wrist. I wish they had changed out the lower legs to give them high boots, but these are just easy repaint exclusives. No new parts. Or are there? It blew my mind when I saw they gave Obi-Wan that cheesy vinyl overlay robe vest thing, and then the orange-brown paint job just. But then, is this the first old man Obi-Wan with photo reel? There's been a few versions, but I think all those were painted. So more realistic eyes and details to the face, but then they tweaked the hair and the beard to be all white, again, like that vintage version. Oh man. This is an auto buy based on nostalgia alone, and I'll probably keep this one carded, but for Greedo, he becomes a random Rodian in the display, and the Jawa can just add to that army. An army building segues into the live stream today where they announced more Lucasfilm 50th anniversary figures. The battle droid looks good on the retro Phantom Menace packaging, and as I think they talked about it, I've already forgotten it, but I wish they could have fit a Comtech chip or a fake Comtech chip, but that would have been more blister, more plastic. A re-release of Mace gives new collectors another chance at him, and again, that Phantom Menace card. If you were able to get in on the Celebration, Obi-Wan, and Darth Maul, this is a good addition to that. Or, rip them open. Jar Jar! We've seen this tactic before. Releasing Jar Jar so close to his deluxe edition just being released, it's kind of a kick in the nuts. But at the same time, if you haven't picked up that deluxe version, now you can go, oh, I'll get the cheaper version later. I don't need that shield. Even though the shield is pretty sweet, saving 10 bucks is kind of sweeter. Or if you're like me, just a complete, utter sucker, you look at it and go, oh, well, maybe I need one on the retro card. But then there's Qui-Gon Jinn, an actual upgrade to a figure people have been asking for when it comes to re-releases. It's an older figure, it's harder to find, and the same can be said for its figure arts counterpart. So getting Qui-Gon back out on the market again, that's nothing but a good thing. But if you look closer, they've also updated the face sculpt so that it can accept the photoreal process. They couldn't do it on the original Black Series version. If you remember that, it wasn't bad, but it really gave off serial killer wearing a human skin mask vibe. I feel like Qui-Gon will be the first one you want to pre-order in this set, which will be Best Buy exclusive. I've seen the complaints of the overall concept of retro carding, but this is exactly what exclusive should be. Not needed for your collection unless you miss them the first time around, or neat little things for those who dig the nostalgia. If you don't like it, you can pass on by. But then I felt a little let down when they said we have one more reveal for the main Black Series line. Turns out it is an elite squad trooper from the Bad Batch. It's essentially a Phase 2 clone trooper in a dark gray color scheme. Which is cool, I dig some clones, but oh, that's not really a big meat and potatoes top reveal for a live stream. But then the Star Wars team kind of veered away from what they usually do, which is just end it right there. But they did something called pipeline reveals, where they don't actually have the prototypes on hand or the sculpt or whatever, they just have the character names, which is kind of cool. It gives us something to be excited for future live streams. But in that, they announced Tech from the Bad Batch. There's Ara Sing. From The Mandalorian, we're getting Zero and Koska Reeves. And then finally, for the original trilogy diehards, there is General Lando. You guys know me, I'm in for the retro nostalgia grab, especially when there's slightly different paint jobs or a different look. But this is what gets me excited. New characters to continue the line. Today, when it comes to Black Series, it is one mainline pre-order that you can get anywhere, and then Amazon and Best Buy exclusives. But something to look forward to. And that's it for this week. Whew, I'm gonna go take a nap. If you're wanting a closer look at any of these pictures without me all,
I double dare you, mother.
I'll be posting all of that, plus links to pre-orders and more information on the Foosh front page Saturday at noon. And you know, it's taken me 193 episodes to realize that I talk about all these toys and announce that they're on pre-order, but I never put the links to those pre-orders in the description. I don't know why. Honestly, last night I was looking for the pre-order page for the Heavy Metal Tarna and Avis on the Executive Replica site, and I was having trouble. And I was thinking, I wish somebody would post links to this for some kind of reference, make it easier. A-bing! So from now on, I'm gonna attempt to streamline things. If something's on pre-order, head to the description. And if it's not there, head to the comments, call me a dumbass, and tell me, hey, you forgot to put up a pre-order link. But if you enjoyed this Foosh Weekly, comment, like, subscribe. Much love to the Plus. If you're interested in seeing videos early or just in a position to help out the channel, patreon.com. But wherever you may be watching this, I'll always catch you on the Foosh. So much stuff. More often than not, during the weekly, at one point I say, oh, there's so much stuff. Very rarely is it, whew, it's a dead week. And even during the dead weeks, there's quite a bit to talk about. And I think I've talked about it before, but I remember way back when I was, I wonder if people would dig a weekly show with all the toy news. And then thinking to myself, well, will there be enough to talk about? Maybe every 2 weeks or once a month. Imagine once a month, it'd be like an hour or two. That's crazy.